Submitted. Next case for argument is Malley versus San Jose Midtown Development LLC. While the attorneys are transitioning, I just wanted to let all the parties know we plan on taking a short recess after Huntley versus Instagram. Okay, it looks like we have both counsel on video. Can you both hear me?
Yes, Your Honors.
Okay. Mr. Duda?
Good morning, Your Honors. May it please the court. The district court's dismissal of Mr. Malley's action must be reversed for two main reasons. One, the district court erroneously resolved questions of fact as to whether the financial transactions at issue constituted a loan or a joint venture. Alternatively, the district court erroneously disregarded critical parts of documentary evidence proffered in Mr. Malley's complaint. In addition, Mr. Malley has properly alleged usury RICO claims that must be allowed to move forward. On the other end, the district court's denial of attorney fees to the defendants must be affirmed because, number one, Mr. Malley should prevail in this appeal. Number two, the express terms of the contract bar attorney's fees from being imposed. And number three, at this early stage, the overall winner as to Mr. Malley's contract-based claims has not yet been determined. So first, I'll start with looking at the issue of the usury versus a joint venture. The district court erroneously resolved a critical issue of fact, whether the transactions of that issue constitute a loan or a joint venture. And here, the California substantive law is binding under Johnson v. Frankel, which I cited in our papers, as well as Kella Pro-Life Council versus Getman. Under California law, whether a transaction is a joint venture or a loan is a question of fact that must be decided by the fact finder. And this is under the Junkin versus Golden West foreclosure case.
Well, what standards would we use? What standards would a jury use for deciding whether something was a joint venture or a loan? Are those not technical terms, counsel, for which we would have some law that would help us understand the difference between a loan and a joint venture?
Yes, Your Honor, there is a multi-factor test that is spelled out under Junkin and other cases. One is whether the transaction reflects an absolute obligation of repayment, whether the investor may suffer a quote risk of loss, whether the investor has any right to participate in management, and along with the identity of the seller of the property at issue. And under California law, the presence or absence of any one factor is not conclusive when characterizing a transaction. And this is, again, from Junkin.
But doesn't your argument focus upon the fact that the usury claim that you're making, essentially you're classifying a capital call as a loan, and the usury claim that you're making is essentially, it relies on an interpretation of a contract. Isn't it not correct that the other minority investors, none of them have joined in this lawsuit? Your client stands alone, does he not?
My client is the only one who was sued, although as we have alleged in our papers, there are two other individuals who were required to take out such loans, and that's Mr. Rosendahl. Well,
but you use the word loan, but the simple fact of the matter is that there it was a capital call, and those who answered the capital call would have their equity increased, and those that did not would not have their equity increased. But that is a legal determination, following up upon Judge Bybee's question in terms of an interpretation of a contract. It's not a question of fact. It's an illegal interpretation as to try to classify this as a loan to which the usury laws would apply.
Your Honor, two responses there. Number one, as I mentioned, California law stipulates that the determination of whether a transaction is a joint venture or loan is a question of fact. But and second of all, and this is really important, critical to the factual inquiry of whether a transaction or set of transactions constitute a loan or a joint venture, the fact finder must not only examine formal agreements, but two things. One, documents generated by the transactions, and this is from the Borner versus Colwell case, and two, the party's course of conduct, and that's from the West Pico Furniture case. So what we have here is we have alleged a large amount of evidence that reflects the fact that terminology reflecting loans is replete within the course of conduct and within the transaction here.
Well, I'm not sure if the key case here that I understand it under California law to be the Junkin case, correct? The 2010 opinion?
That is one of the cases.
It's a key case, is it not? In that the California appellate court under state law has clearly said a joint venture or partnership that requires its partners to make advances is an investment, and specifically said as a matter of law that it's not a loan. And I'm not really sure how you dance around that in terms of the facts of this case.
Well, Your Honor, essentially this is a multi-part test, and no one single factor is conclusive. And that's going to our point, which is that this is something that the trial court should not have this is a case that the trial court should not have interrupted during a motion to dismiss stage. This is something where a jury or a fact finder should have looked into all of the factors involved before coming up with its conclusion.
Tell me what facts are critical that the district court decided that it should have been decided by a jury?
Well, it can't be
the ultimate question, was this a loan or a joint venture? Because a jury would have absolutely no basis. They'd be free skating. They'd have no idea what those terms meant and what they were to decide. So what facts are in dispute that are material that the district court decided and should not have?
Well, Your Honor, for example, the defendants repeatedly used terms associated with loans, including interest, line of credit, borrowing members, and annual rate, which compounds daily. And this is from the exhibit 7 or 8 from the second amended complaint. So that's 4 ER 449 to 451. There is documentation that is emails from a key member who later became a manager of the LLC, that is Mr. Patel, in which he stated that the LLC had amended its operating agreement, quote, to allow for a line of credit, which, quote, would allow borrowing members to fund their capital call requirements from contributing members. And then he also stated in that same email from January 2017, the line of credit is secured by borrowing members' economic interest and is at a 20% annual rate, which compounds daily and can be paid down any time by the borrowing member. And this is from 4 ER 438, that's exhibit 3 to the second amended complaint. And what's important, what's also significant here, is that we also have the manager's accounting statement for the $11.2 million sale at issue here. And that's from 4 ER 449 to 451. And there it showed that, you know, there are many items there with interest rates ranging from 20 to 40%, comprised of items such as delinquent capital contribution interest of 20%, an environmental line of credit interest of 20%, a legal 20% bonus interest.
Counsel, if we were to conclude that this was absolutely a joint venture, what terms should the agreements have used in place of those terms? What terms would a joint venture have used? So your contention is all of those terms indicate that this is a loan, and those are clearly terms that are used in loans. What terms should a joint venture have used to indicate that this was a joint venture and not a loan?
Well, the terms there should not have been mention of the word interest. There should not have been mention of the word compounding. You know,
I'm sorry, Judge Bobby.
What word would we have used instead of interest or compounding? Aren't those sort of the kind of a plain understanding? These are accounting terms, they're economic terms, they're terms in common usage so that people would understand what was going on. But if you're going to tell me that they shouldn't have used the term interest, you've got to tell me what kind of a term they should have used if it was a joint venture.
If I can just follow up on Judge Bybee's question, answer a compound question with that is that essentially the facts of this case are clear that if a member chooses not to answer the capital call, their equity was to be reduced, and it could remain just being reduced because they had less equity unless they would remunerate that amount, and that's where a matter of interest would come in if they chose to remunerate it in some way. They were free to just not answer the capital call, and their equity would be reduced. Isn't that correct?
Okay.
Is that not correct? Is that not the record? That if they chose not to answer the capital call, their investment was just going to be, their equity position would just be reduced. Is that not correct?
That is correct, Your Honor, but the key is whether or not they choose to accept what we vehemently consider to be a loan. Then if that happened, their equity interest would not be changed. And more importantly, the equity interest of the borrower, of the lending members, was not changed either. And that is through, through undisputed evidence from an email from the defendants. That's that email from January 24th, 2017 that I referenced to earlier. So that reflects that this was a loan, because if this had not been a loan, then there would have been an adjustment made to the equity. And the other point I wish to make is that on a motion to dismiss, all inferences must be drawn in favor of the plaintiff, and in any benefit of the doubt must be given to the plaintiff at this early stage. And this is from the Usher versus Los Angeles case that was cited. So, so here we have provided sufficient evidentiary indicia, reflecting the fact that this arrangement was a loan. I mean, these were three members of the LLC who accepted this arrangement, and they accepted a loan, and they were subject to interest rates of whopping interest rates of 20-40%. This is a rather rare.
Where does the operating agreement provides that the members who default on their obligations may have their equity reduced? Where does it impose an absolute obligation of repayment on those who make that decision? Where is there anything in the operating agreement that imposes that obligation upon them to try to create this as a loan?
It's not in the operating agreement, but it's implicit from the economic circumstances, from the circumstances of the real estate deal, the $11.2 million sale, and from case law showing that it's not just the agreement that matters, it's also the course of conduct, it's also the documents generated by the transaction. That's really important, because basically the California courts recognize that that lenders who are trying to make usurious loans dress it up sometimes and use subterfuge. And for that reason, the courts, in this case, Borner versus Colwell and West Pico Furniture, that's a state Supreme Court, California State Supreme Court, they look beyond the agreement and look at the actual transaction, how it played out, the course of conduct, and the documents generated. And what we have done here is we have provided documentary evidence showing language and documents reflecting the fact that this was a loan, that everyone considered this a loan, that terminology was used such that it was a loan. I mean, there was an email from March 2018 where the LLC's manager, J.C. Martin, noted that, quote, it was ridiculous, quote, that the LLC was requiring Mr. Malley to pay, quote, 20% interest initially, increasing to 25% on March 1, to 30% on May 1, then to 40% on June 1. And this is from 4 ER 440. I realize my time is going down. I'd like to reserve time, but if your honors have questions.
Yeah, just one other. Just if I'm not, correct me if I'm wrong, the whole basis of your being in federal court was classifying this as a civil RICO action. You still have a state cause of action, but you were in federal court totally on the basis of trying to assert a civil RICO action, correct?
That's correct, Your Honor.
And this is basically, this entire matter involves one single commercial transaction and the sale, one sale of one piece of property. Is that correct?
Ultimately, it reflects the sale of an $11.2 million property. Right. But when it comes to,
but you sought to, you've alleged some kind of pattern of conduct within the ambit of the civil RICO statute.
Yes, Your Honor, and this is really important because when you're alleging RICO usury, you don't need to allege the same pattern of conduct, and that's under the Goldenstein versus Repossessors case, as well as a number of other cases. For example, U.S. v. Groh, 961 F3rd 105, pinpoint site 119, that's from the Second Circuit. U.S. versus Oredo, 37 F3rd 739, pinpoint site 751, that's from the First Circuit. U.S. versus Arcoin, 964 F2nd 1492, pinpoint site 1495 to 1497.
Okay, thank you, counsel. We'll give you a minute on rebuttal.
Thank you.
Go ahead.
May it please the court. My name is Mark Benninghausen, and I represent San Jose Midtown Development, which is the LLC entity, and five individual members of that LLC who were sued by Mr. Malley. I think the panel has nailed in on what is wrong with any theory in this case. And in fact, as the record reflects, we thought this was a Rule 11 sanctionable pleading to begin with. I think it's important for the context here. This was a successful venture, but in the few cases I've seen where Mr. Malley could have recovered $400,000 for his $77,000 investment, but he decided to sue while every other member in the entity accepted their terrific return on the money they invested and went on their way. And Mr. Malley, who refused to put any more money into this venture while it was embroiled in years of litigation, always threatened to sue at the time there might be money coming for the sale of the property. And he threatened in 2019, as the record reflects, it was always state court. I'm going ex parte state court. And in fact, when this happened in 2020, he again threatened to go in state court. And I submit the reason we're in federal court is because the pandemic hit. And then he couldn't go to state court because they closed ex parte. And the whole plan here was to try to tie up the money for all these members, not allow them to release it, and then negotiate more money than he was entitled to. Now, our position is he ginned up this RICO claim to try to get the federal court to get a TRO to stop the distribution, which he lost without any opposition. The plain fact here is there is no plausible RICO claim because the contract that Mr. Malley signed shows exactly what happened here. This was an equity investment that people who put more money in got a preferred return until other people got, until they got their money out. Then it would go to the other members who did not put in more money into the venture. If this is found to support a usury claim, I submit, every deal in Silicon Valley is subject to a usury RICO action. This is how investments work. If a venture is having problems and they need more money, the new money that comes in can negotiate preferred returns on their equity. Preferred equity. That's happened a lot of times. I had another case in state court. The exact same thing happened. The preferred equity received all the money from the sale of the transaction. That's the way it works. If someone has money and can negotiate terms that gives them more money, that gives them a better return out of the first money coming out, that is a standard financing.
Counsel, to follow up with Judge Bybee's question, wouldn't then the better language in the operating agreement be preferred equity instead of interest and things of that nature?
Well, I don't think so, because as Judge Bybee said, these are common economic terms. Okay.
What you mean is interest is really preferred equity, isn't it?
Well, you're saying as I get interest on my money of the equity before it comes out. Okay. So the equity accumulates a return, a mandatory return, unreduced from the investment. Okay. That's That's a standard phrase. It's also sometimes called a liquidation preference. If I'm liquidating an asset, I get a certain interest on my money that I put in as equity, but it all comes out of the profit. I mean, the key thing on a loan is that there's a mandatory repayment. It's unrelated to the profit for the venture. Okay. Now, here, the predicate act was a supposed illegal usurious loan. But there was no loan in this case, let alone a usurious one. I mean, Civil Code Section 1912 of the California Civil Code defines a loan. It is, I am giving money to someone else with repayment of that money. I mean, you got to think of what the context here is. The money is going to the LLC. It's not going to Mr. Malley. The equity investment is going to the LLC so it can pay its bills. There's no money being loaned to Mr. Malley because the
LLC... Unless my colleagues have any questions, can we move on to the attorney's fees question?
Yes, I think that probably is advisable. Okay.
Hey, so, okay. Yeah, if you want to introduce that... And I have some questions for you.
With respect to the civil RICO case, the court, to the extent that strategy is undertaken, it also has the potentiality of treble damages and attorney's fees, right?
Yeah, I mean it's a leverage play, I think, as to why they pleaded.
We are correct in understanding this was the only investor, what I'll call a minority investor, who challenged in this fashion, correct?
Yes, the other two people who were in Mr. Malley's situation, which were the people who didn't have any more money to put in, they signed what was required to get their distribution, and they went on their way like all of my clients want to do. Mr. Malley didn't sue them. I don't know why.
They just accepted reduced equity, correct? No, there's no obligation for them to borrow money, and they just accepted reduced equity. Isn't that correct?
Well, they accepted that the people who put in more money got a preferred return before their equity was paid. Exactly right.
I'm sorry.
That's fine. That's
okay. So, I won't go on. The rest of the RICO elements are nowhere met as well. But going to the attorney's fees issue, and I cross appealed this because it's an interesting issue, I think. Now. Point is, the trial court made a finding that was not argued at all by Mr. Malley. Reading the arbitration saying that fees were only awarded in arbitration as a limitation on awarding of attorney's fees. Our argument on that is that it's a waiver, that you can't rely on a arbitration limitation on fees when you refuse to arbitrate.
Did you seek to compel arbitration?
Well, we did, except Mr. Malley is quite a litigant. He said we could arbitrate. I think he was wrong. But our view was that we would be probably better off in federal court dealing with these RICO claims. It probably might be cheaper because we'd have to pay an arbitrator. But we told him to bring your claims in arbitration. He refused.
You didn't file a motion before the federal district court to compel arbitration, correct?
We did not. But we think we have that option because he's waiving his right to arbitrate. We can accept his waiver.
Sure, you accept his waiver, but that means you also waive your attorney's fees under the operating agreement.
I don't think so, Your Honor. That's our view, because I think the person you look at is a person who's trying to take advantage of the arbitration provision. Here, Mr. Malley refused to arbitrate, but now wants to take advantage of the limitation to arbitration fees. I think that's the waiver. And I think...
Just to be clear, you're only asking for attorney's fees under the operating agreement, right? No other basis of law.
Yeah, it's 1717 claim.
So under the operating agreement, there is no provision for attorney's fees if you refuse to arbitrate. It's only if you arbitrate. So you want us to read into another clause into the operating agreement?
No, I don't think it's only if you arbitrate. It's the way the language, it's not the best language, I'll agree, is that the arbitration, you awarded fees for the arbitration proceedings. It was not like if you only arbitrate, you get fees. It starts out, it's a very broad language. It's the 10.1 of the agreement. It's any dispute.
Counsel, it looks to me like you've just got a slam dunk if you go to the court and say we're filing a motion to arbitrate, to compel arbitration, because it was the exclusive dispute resolution. And so when you let that go and you don't file that, that looks like you've waived the possibility as well. And that goes then to Judge Bumate's question, which is, all right, if 10.1 is no longer in effect, it's not the exclusive dispute resolution mechanism, then what other provision of law authorizes the shifting in attorney's fees?
I think you ignore the arbitration and apply the fees in 10.1. That's our position. I will admit this hasn't been decided, but the Cali case at 109 Calap 4-769 specifically leaves that issue open, because there the court said the question then would be whether the party's agreement providing for fees only for prevailing party to what was intended to be mandatory arbitration could be interpreted to cover subsequently agreed to court litigation. Of course, we need not decide that question here. I'll admit there's not a California case on point on that, but this case, the Cali case versus Gray, makes clear that is not foreclosed. And we submit that you've got to look at the party who's looking for the protection of the arbitration provision as to whether they waived that right, not the party who's trying to get the fees because they agreed with the person who decided to waive their right to arbitration. As we said in our brief, and I think this is somewhat consistent with the U.S. Supreme Court in the recent Morgan versus Sundance case, where a party started in court and they said, no, I want to go to arbitration. And the court said, no, you were too far along. You can't then say, I want to go back to arbitration, because you waived the right to the use of arbitration. Here I submit, once Mr. Malley decided to forego arbitration, he can't now say, I don't want to pay fees on the loss of a dispute on the merits between members.
Why not? Under the operating agreement, it seems like he could.
I just think he waives that right once he decides to forego arbitration.
But textually, where does that exist?
I just think you can read 10.1 that way. That.
Let me press you on that. How? I can't see how.
Well, I think the broad language that the attorney's fees are awarded with regard to any dispute, it doesn't say just an arbitration of any dispute between the members.
It says the prevailing party shall be entitled to reimbursement of attorney's fees, costs, and expenses incurred in connection with the arbitration.
But that's just the process. But with regard to the liability, it's any dispute, not just an arbitration dispute. That limitation is on the forum, not the type of dispute. So I'm saying that as soon as he waived the forum, then you just apply the language to say prevailing party of any dispute, which includes RICO claims under Chang and Stip. And that's the way to read that, because to allow a party, and I'll be frank about this. This is why Mr. Malley did not raise this below, because of course he's now in state court on another action. Okay? And he's going to want attorney's fees there, even though he's waived his right to arbitration again. I don't think it should be on the party who gets sued in court and decides to defend itself in court and agrees to the plaintiff's forum to be forced to compel arbitration and then don't get the protection of the fee provision that just relies on the plaintiff actually following the contract and bringing it in the forum, especially when we told him to.
There's always the possibility that your clients thought, or that you thought, it was advantageous to have your clients in federal court rather than before an arbitrator. And if so, that's a waiver on your client's part. We don't have any way of judging that from here.
I agree, but I don't think that's the way. You look at the waiver on the party who brings the lawsuit. I think that's the way it is as to waiving that right. Because obviously we accepted the form in federal court, and the same thing, he pled the attorney's fees. I mean, there's a good law in California, which we cited. You're stopped from asserting no payment of attorney's fees when you plead it. If it's possible, they'll be awarded. If he wanted to waive his attorney's fees or have this protection, he should have said so in his pleading. I'm waiving my right to arbitration and the right to collect fees. I don't think it's our requirement to say we're waiving our right to collect fees when he's the one who selected the form. So I think the law supports and should encourage the enforcement of a fee provision when it's the plaintiff who selects the forum and foregoes the arbitration at his risk.
And in fact, the Mr. Malley requested an award of attorney's fees in each version of his complaint, did he not?
Yes, he's pursuing these attorney's fees.
In the operative second amended complaint, once again, he affirmatively requested attorney's fees.
Yes, if he was telling us that he was entitled to fees under this contract that he had pled, despite him deciding not to bring arbitration. And we want to hold him to that interpretation.
Thank you, counsel. Mr. Duda, we'll give you 1 minute. Sir, you're on mute.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, thank you, Your Honors. I'll be very quick with some very quick points. Number one is that I want to emphasize that the LLC held my client's money hostage in the sense that if he didn't agree not to sue the LLC or any of its members or agents, then he wouldn't get any money. That's in section 5.9 of the operating agreement. Number two, the other two victims of this loan scheme, it's true that they didn't sue. They accepted reduced distributions, you know, based on the loans that they made. So, you know, the language here, again, has to look, you have to look at the course of conduct, and you also have to look at the documentary evidence. Now, when it comes to attorney's fees, the American rule applies here. That is, unless there is some...
Okay, so what rule were you relying on when you asked for attorney's fees?
Your Honor, it's true that we did ask for attorney's fees. That was just a set process that we're looking in here. And I would mention that the district court had the discretion, and it was not limited to the particular legal theories advanced by the parties under Thompson v. Runnels from this court in 2013. This was an unusual situation where the defendants did not make any move to compel arbitration.
Now, why didn't you agree to arbitration? You were obligated to do so under the agreement.
We believe that there were legal reasons why, and we had exchanged correspondence with the other side that why arbitration would not apply. I would note that the other side also threatened to file a Rule 11 motion against my client for reasons that were entirely inappropriate. And that's why they did not file a Rule 11, because they would have been subject to sanctions themselves for making factually false claims in their papers.
Counsel, I'm still unclear on what basis you thought you had for requesting attorney's fees. What's the fee shifting? What would be the fee shifting provision?
Your Honor, we originally at this sought fees because it was our position at that time that arbitration was not applicable to this dispute.
Okay.
So that was our position at the time.
Okay, and so what fee shifting provision would have allowed your client to recover attorney's fees?
There would have been.
Did you have no basis for requesting attorney's fees in the complaint?
Well, Your Honor, we looked at the arbitration clause, And, you know, and we determined that if there was a possibility that attorney's fees could apply in
the okay so situation. You so your basis was the same clause that your opponent now is asking for attorney's fees under. You thought 10.1 would authorize fees if you won.
We thought 10.1 could authorize fees. However, in this particular case, both under there is case law from the Ninth Circuit dealing with Chang v. Chen, which says that if the arbitration clause does not allow for fees, then it won't allow it. And this is really important. Under the dispute suite case from the state Supreme Court, no fees can be awarded under Section 1717 unless there's been the entirety of the matter has been litigated overall. So,
counsel, I haven't heard an answer to my question except for Section 10.1. So it's, from everything that you've told me, the only basis you had for asking for attorney's fees was the arbitration provision in the operating agreement.
Yes, that was the basis there. Thank Again, you. Under dispute suite, it's very important to know that this is a law, this is California law applies here when it comes to 1717, the interpretation of it. And the state Supreme Court, which is binding, whose ruling is binding on this court, set forth that you have to look at who the winner is for all of the case. And what is undisputed is that most of the contract-based claims are now in the state superior court, and they're in the process of being litigated, and there's no clear winner yet. And this case was quoted by a federal court in Allied Professionals versus Harmon, 2017 WL 563-4870. So there, since there's been no final resolution of the contract claims, there can be no, there, at this point, it's not, there can be no determination of who the winner will be. And
okay, counsel, if you want to wrap up, you're about 4 minutes over.
Yes, I will. Thank you, Your Honors. Just to wrap up on the attorney's fees part of it, because there's no final resolution of Mr. Malley's claims, this court is in no position to determine who prevailed overall. And this is from Dispute Suite 2 Cal 5th, 968.
Okay, thank you. Counsel, I think we have your argument. We appreciate it. This case is submitted.